Listening Library presents Children of the Longhouse by Joseph Bruchac. Read for you by Elaina Erika Davis.
Chapter 1. Grabber's Plan. Ohkwa'ri. His hands pressed on the hard earth of the hillside, Ohkwa'ri felt the footfalls of people coming before he heard or saw them. He leaned forward and looked through the branches of the shrub oak, which were green with leaves. Several people were coming up the trail. He recognized the one who led them. It was Grabber. From his shaded hiding place where he had dug out the loose earth under a slanting slab of stone, Ohkwa'ri could see out through the branches and not be seen. He had crawled in to get out of the hot noon rays of the bright sun of the strawberry moon, that time of year when the days are the longest. This hiding place was his own and no one else's. The little cave and the hill on the other side of the river from his busy village were the two spots where he always came to think. No one knew about this cave except for his sister Ojitjia, whom he trusted with everything. Ohkwa'ri thought to crawl out, but for some reason, though his mind thought of showing himself, his body held back. Then Grabber began to speak to his friends, and Ohkwa'ri knew that it was good he had not allowed himself to be seen. The things that Grabber was saying here on the hillside far above their village were not things that he wanted anyone to overhear. Grabber was talking about starting a war. When Ohkwa'ri was very small, he had admired Grabber, who was 5 winters older than him. Grabber was straight-limbed and very strong. He was the fastest runner of all the young men, a hard worker, and a good hunter. He was the best at all the games the young men played. Whether it was the game of Degwa'aladon in the spring, when they caught the hard deerskin ball in their webbed sticks and ran back and forth in the playing field to score goals, or Snow Snake in the winter, when they threw their long, finely carved spears down an ice trough to watch them skitter great distances, Grabber was almost always the first among the young men. Because of that, he had a loyal group of close friends, and he was always praised for his abilities. Now that Ohkwa'ri had seen 11 winters, he no longer admired Grabber in the same way. Despite his physical abilities, Grabber was impatient. Although he usually won, he sulked on the few times when he lost. Often he had an angry look on his face, and he did not listen well to the advice of the older men. He always thought his own way of doing things for the good of the people was the best. "Those Anendags," Grabber was saying, "those eaters of bark are not real men. They are cowards. We are real human beings. If our fathers and our uncles were not too old and tired, they would see this clearly." "That is true," said Greasy Hair. Greasy Hair was always at Grabber's side, ready to do whatever his friend suggested. A small village of the Anendags was just over the mountain pass, 3 days' journey upriver from the big falls, and then an equal number of days' journey up the big lakes. Although there were more Anendags in all their scattered villages than there were Longhouse people, the Anendag villages were often quite small, smaller than those of the Longhouse people, and thus easier to raid.
"We should raid them," Grabber said, "because they have not traded fairly with us."
Even though Grabber's statement was not true, Greasy Hair agreed loudly. "Hang," he said.
"When will we make the raid on their village?" asked a third person's voice.
From his hiding place under the shelf of rock, Ohkwa'ri could not see that person. Grabber was sitting right in front of the cave, and his back blocked Ogwali's view of the others. But he recognized the slow, growling voice. It was Eats Like a Bear, the biggest of all the young men in the village and another of Grabber's 3 constant companions. Now, Ohkwa'ri thought, Falzalot will ask that same question if he is also here. Sure enough, The next voice to speak was that of the rather slow-thinking young man who almost always repeated the same questions asked by his friends.
"Yes," said the voice of Falzalot. "When will we make the raid on their village?"
Grabber looked around. For a moment, his eyes rested on the hidden entrance of the cave, and Ohkwa'ri's heart beat faster. Ohkwa'ri remembered a story that Ojiji'a had told him during the winter, the story of a boy who accidentally overheard a group of two-hearted people who had made an old man sick through their bad magic. The two-hearted people did not see that boy hidden in the spruce tree, Ohkwa'ri thought. "So Grabber will not see me here. He will look away." Grabber looked back toward his friends.
"We will make the raid while the festival to thank the strawberries is going on. While the people are dancing, we will strike the enemy."
When the four young men had gone back down the hill, Ohkwa'ri came out of his cave. He was very troubled by the words they had spoken. It was true that the Anen Thugs were a different nation. It was true that they spoke a language strange to the people of the Flint Nation, but it was also true that they were now at peace. Once the Anen Thugs had been their enemies, but now the people of the Flint Nation often traded with them. Each year, after the corn harvest, people from Ohkwa'ri's village would travel to the meeting place on the other side of the big south-flowing river, Skanedade Gahunda, the river beyond the openings. The one in particular that they liked were the fine canoes of birch bark made by the Anen Thugs. In the old days, before meeting the Anen Thugs, the canoes of the five nations of the Longhouse people had always been made of elm bark. The Anen Thugs taught them how to make birch bark canoes. Yet even though they knew how to make canoes of birch bark, it seemed as if the most beautiful and the finest canoes were always made by the Anen Thug people themselves. Although they would never be as close to Ohkwa'ri's people as the four nations which, with his Flint Nation people, made up their great league of peace, the Anen Thugs respected the people of the Flint Nation and honored the peace. Until now, all the people of the Flint Nation had returned that respect and kept that peace. Ohkwa'ri thought he understood why those three other young men were in agreement with Grabber's plan. They were impatient. They had not been successful in gaining the respect they thought they deserved. It seemed clear that none of them would ever be a loyane, a leader of men, or a faith keeper. Nor was it likely that any of them would ever become a pine tree chief, chosen to sit in council with the loyane. There was no sign that Grabber or any of the others who followed his lead were wise enough or careful enough to hold such a position of honor. So they had decided to make their names by doing great deeds in a war that no one else wanted. The words that Grabber had spoken continued to trouble Ohkwa'ri as he walked across the hill toward the strawberry fields, where he knew his sister and the other women would still be gathering berries. The festival to thank the strawberries would begin the next morning. His own first impulse was to find the four larger boys and confront them. He would tell Grabber and his friends that their hot-headed idea was wrong. No one should break the Great Peace without a good reason or go to war without the agreement of all the people. But then Ohkwa'ri remembered what his twin sister had told him just the day before. "Brother," Ojiji'a had said, "you must sometimes think before you do things." Ojiji'a understood things better than he did. He had trusted her thoughts before, and he would do so now. The strawberry fields were a wide expanse of meadow not far from the river. The people kept that area clear by burning it each autumn before the snows returned. As a result, there were always many strawberry plants. At this time of the year, those red berries, each shaped like a little heart, glowed like embers in the new grass. There were many girls and women still picking, although Ohkwa'ri could see that some were already heading back up the trail to the big longhouse, carrying baskets that had been filled with many berries. It was easy to locate Ojiji'a. As soon as Ohkwa'ri had come to the edge of the fields, She had looked up and raised a hand in greeting. Because they were twins, they always.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.